fortunate gathering to commemorate the 41st, in this case, the 41st anniversary of the continuing illegal occupation of Cyprus, which the invasion occurred in July 20th of 74. I'll say some things later on, but right now, I'd like to call to the podium a good friend of the Greek American community and issues involving the southeastern Mediterranean. As I always like to say, these are not parochial issues that involve Greece or Cyprus. These are issues that involve the United States of America and its interest in the region. And therefore, at this time, I'd like to call Chris Van Hollen, a great, great friend, to the podium.
Thank you, Nick. Thank you very much. It's great to be here this morning for what Nick said really is a solemn occasion. And it is deeply disturbing that we are here now 41 years later without a resolution to the unjust situation on Cyprus. I want to thank Nick. I want to thank everybody associated with AHI for their continued efforts to make sure we focus continued attention on this injustice. To the representatives from the Greek embassy who are here, welcome. Please give my best to the Cypriot ambassador and the Greek ambassador. It's great to be here with my colleague, Joe Crowley, and I see Albio Ceres joined us, two great friends of Cyprus. Let me just say this, as somebody who's worked together with the Greek American community and the Cypriot American community on these issues for many years, since I served way back on the Senate Foreign Relations Committee staff with Senator Claiborne Pell and Paul Sarbanes, we're not going to give up. And we know after the recent elections in the North, there is some opportunity here. But we also know from past experience that the Turkish government remains the key to getting an agreement. And while the UN special advisor made some very positive comments about his most recent meeting, and that is some reason for cautious optimism, we also know that President Erdogan made some very counterproductive comments that were not just rebuffed by the Greek side, but also by the Turkish Cypriot leader, because what President Erdogan said was the northern part, Cyprus, is really the Turkish homeland. And if it continues to take that position, Turkey will continue to prevent us from moving forward on this fundamental issue of justice. So, as Nick said, this is not just an issue important to people in Cyprus. It's not just an issue important to people in the Eastern Mediterranean. This is an issue important to the world. It's about the rule of law. It's about democracy, and it's about justice. And I am absolutely convinced that justice will prevail, and I want to thank everybody gathered in this room for bringing us together on this solemn occasion, but also for all the work done during the year to make sure that we never forget here in the United States, because the people in Cyprus can never forget, because this is something with them every day. So thank all of you for your efforts. I continue to stand with you to work to make sure we see justice is done in Cyprus. Thank you very much.
We have a couple more members that have joined us here, and Joe Crowley, who's been an advocate on these issues for many, many years. Welcome, Congressman. Good to have you with us.
Thank you. Thank you, kindly. Appreciate you having me here. I'm going to be brief. I'm going to be more brief than Chris. Chris is running for the U.S. Senate in Maryland, and I'm not. So you should understand, I'm not even from Maryland.
You're saying those senators can't stop talking.
Sorry? Exactly. Just can't stop. But like Chris and Albio, we have a Democratic caucus that started about 10 minutes ago. And I, being the vice chair of the Democratic caucus, need to be at the Democratic caucus. So, but I did want to stop by here. I know that Albio has been a strong, long-time supporter of the Greek Cypriot community as well, and for the cause of United Cyprus. And it's important, I think, that we be here, that more members stop by. I'm sure you're going to have a great cadre of people from both sides of the aisle. I know Carolyn Maloney, who's my next-door neighbor in terms of my district. I live in Queens, and I cover Northern Astoria. Carolyn has Southern Astoria, and very proud of the Greek populace that has been a part of Queens County for so many years. In fact, Astoria was the largest concentration of Greeks outside of Athens. I think to some degree there may be other Australian right now. But I was first introduced to the issue of Cyprus when I was a young man. In fact, I was a boy. My uncle, Walter Crowley, who was a New York City councilman, was a politico in New York City, was great friends with his political godfather, was a man by the name of Pete Chehalis, who was a Greek-American from Massapequa, Queens. And I was 12 when the invasion took place, but I was very, very aware of it, because I was very aware of my own family ties to our motherland as well, in Ireland, and what was going on in terms of partition and what was happening in Northern Ireland. I was very aware of international relations, even as a young man. And I had the opportunity to travel to Cyprus 15 years ago. And I saw the beauty of the land. I also saw the ugliness of the situation, of the line that divided the Greek and the Turks, Turkish community on the island itself. And as we commemorate the 41st anniversary, we as a nation, the United States, must continue to recognize that Cyprus cannot be a divided country. It ought not to be divided. We should find a way to bring it together and not recognize the invasion as legitimate. It was an invasion. It was unlawful. And that doesn't change. But I have hope that with a new day brings a new discussion, opportunity for reunification of Cyprus. But I do think failing to recognize it as illegal, failing to recognize it as an invasion, gives opportunity to other invasions, which we see happening around the world today, that we also must condemn and not support. So I will continue in my role to be an outspoken advocate for the Greek Cypriot community, as well as the Cypriot community as a whole, and for reunification of a wonderful, wonderful island. So thank you. God bless you all for working with us.
Before I call Congressman Sears to the microphone, let me just recognize the two ambassadors who just walked in the room, Ambassador of Greece, Christos Panagopoulos, and the Ambassador of Cyprus to the United States, George Chakadi. Welcome. And as mentioned, and he's in the room, and I got to know him on a trip to Greece and Cyprus, I guess now it's done, it's been quite a few years ago. Alvio, and it was a pleasure to meet you then, and I appreciated your passion and interest for the issue that you've continued to carry on, and you've done a tremendous job advocating for this issue, and we thank you very much, and we welcome you here today.
Thank you. Nice to meet you. I'll also be brief because we do have a caucus meeting, but I wanted to stop here. I haven't had a chance to stop in the last one or two, but I've been to Cyprus, you know, and it is an invasion, and it is illegal. And it's insulting to go to Cyprus and go and see on a hill the Turkish flag, how it just over the people of Cyprus. Went to the green zone. And over the years, I have worked on all the issues. I visited some of the churches that are rotting. I met the mayor of Augusta, you know, that beautiful city there. You know, when you get comments from the Prime Minister of Turkey like he made, it just angers me more. I've been here 10 years. I think every year, at least two, three times a year, I get invited to go to Turkey. I haven't gone. Because I'm a believer that if I stand for an issue, I am not going to go there and shake hands with people who I disagree with on the issue. So I'm here, you know, to support you, and I admire your effort. You just don't give up. And that's the way it should be. You know, and I see a lot of young people here, which is very gratifying because you are the next generation that is going to work on this issue. And it is an important issue. It's an important issue to have a united Cyprus. So, you know what my office is? You know that I work closely with the members, so and I thank you. And it was nice to hear Chris Van Hollen speak, because you couldn't have a better advocate for United Cyprus in the U.S. Senate than Chris Van Hollen, and obviously my colleague, Joe. So I thank you very much, and I do have to go. We do have a caucus meeting. Well, I have a full day for that. Nice to meet you.
You know, at a time when you hear Congress being challenged on principle and morals, well, here's a man obviously who stands up for principle and morals, and we thank you for that, Congressman. Appreciate that very much. As we have a number of more members who have indicated they're going to stop by, what I'll do at this time is just sort of give my comments, and I'd like to have the ambassadors talk, but hopefully we can get a member or two come in before they say some comments. So I'll go ahead and just give my for-the-record comments now. If I didn't introduce myself earlier in the haste of how we started, my name is Nick Larigakis. I'm the president of the American Hellenic Institute. HI is an independent Greek American think tank public policy organization here in the nation's capital, and it is my pleasure to officially welcome you here today to this, our, as I said earlier, our unfortunate 41-year commemoration anniversary of the illegal invasion and continuing occupation of Cyprus back in 1974, which was illegal because it occurred in two phases and was in violation of U.S. laws, the U.N. Charter, the NATO Treaty, and customary international law. Today, 41 years later, Turkey continues the illegal occupation of Cyprus, an EU member nation, which again continues in violation of the rule of law. And may I add, that EU country called Cyprus has been recently bolstered in terms of the U.S. strategic partnership, according to Vice President Joe Biden, when he visited Cyprus there in 2014 and made the statement to the above. However, there have been recent developments to the Cyprus issue that warrant our consideration today. Settlement talks have resumed after a seven-month period when Turkey made egregious incursions into Cyprus's exclusive economic zone that resulted in the suspension of the negotiations and unnecessarily elevated tensions in the eastern Mediterranean. Under new Turkish Cypriot leadership, we are cautiously optimistic about the current state of the renewed settlement of talks. But we realize all too well that the problem, as well as the solution to the Cyprus issue, resides in Ankara. This morning, we look forward to hearing from our champions on Capitol Hill, some of them which we heard right now, who have been advocating for this issue for many years. I would also like to take a moment to thank the co-chairs of the Hellenic Caucus, and I will do so again when they come. And that, of course, is Congressman Larakis and Carolyn Maloney. So what we'll do now is we'll continue with the breakfast, and we expect some more members to come. And in a few minutes, we'll also call the two ambassadors to come up and to say a few words as well. So again, thank you for being here today, and we'll continue in a few minutes. Thank you. Actually, we're going to go ahead and have the ambassador of Greece, Spanagopoulos, who's been just a little bit challenged recently with some of the developments that you might have been hearing about in the news, but he's doing a tremendous job of representing his government here in Washington. And we thank him for being here today this commemoration. Ambassador.
Thank you very much, Nick. First of all, I can thank you so very much, American Hellenic Institute, you as a leader, and there's so many young people. And I say that because I'm going to say, join voice with you today, say something from my heart. I've had the honor to represent Greece in Cyprus for 5 years. Every Greek feels about this terrible crime. Now more reason, because I was involved. And I see that's a shame for the United Nations, for the European Union, to keep something unthinkable in Cyprus today. As Nick said, thanks to the congressional leaders who have been here already, but they're going to become more, I believe. You can't imagine how much help they give us to continue our struggle. 41 years, doesn't matter. Since we are determined to bring justice, we're going to do it no matter what, how many years are going to pass. And all of us, we do agree that enough is enough. And let's join our forces so we cannot allow another year to lapse. And as Nick said, we are cautiously optimistic. We've been deceived in the past so many times, but we have reason to believe that something might change right now if we take, some kind of new spirit. I bet that my colleague George Akadis is going to elaborate on this, but we hear something more positive this time coming out when the two leaders, they meet. That doesn't mean that anything, because in the past we've seen that and nothing came at the end. But let's hope that next year we're going to celebrate a united Cyprus, a flourishing island, a very dynamic member of the European Union, and the catalyst to bring peace and stability in the region, because Cyprus, even today, under partial occupation, plays a tremendous role when it comes to contribute to the stability and why not prosperity of the whole region. So I see a lot of young people, and please keep up the good job. Thank you very much for the opportunity you give us and to our congressional leaders to help us get out of this shame. Thank you very much.
We are, it's a pleasure to have with us Dina Titus, representing a city which many Greek Americans like to enjoy, called Las Vegas. And we certainly help to that economy. My brothers, as a matter of fact, going there more for 4 days for a conference. So they'll be putting it into some of your coffers out there, I'm sure. Dina, of course, a second time member of Congress, and she's been a tremendous advocate and supporter for the issues of the Southeastern Mediterranean and the rule of law. And Dina, it's a pleasure to have you with us today. I'd like to invite you to make some comments during this very solemn commemoration day today.
Well, thank you. Mr. Ambassador, it's always a pleasure to see you. I really just wanted to come by to say thank you all for being here on the Hill to remind Congress that after 41 years, our country is still divided, our land is still occupied, our families are still displaced, our churches are still threatened, and Turkey is still our enemy. Yet, after 41 years, our resolve is strong, our will is determined, and our hopes are high. And like that barbed wire on the green line, we are connected in this fight and always will be. So count on me. I'm always there. You know where to find me. The ambassador and I visit often, and I very much appreciate his wise counsel. And I hope that you'll come by and see me while you're here. Are you from where? Are you from this area? From all over? I see so many nice young faces here. It's very exciting. Tell me a little about yourselves.
You may open up a can of worms doing that. But anybody want to?
This is like my, you know, I taught political science for 35 years. You're like my students. You're sitting in the back and not saying anything.
Well, my name is Athena Balta. I was born in Greece, but I've been living here for 20 years. So I have an interest in the Greek-American relations and issues and the Cypriot-American relations and issues. And I have my own legal practice. I do a lot of business law, immigration law, and litigation.
Well, thank you so much for being here. I think you all know David Rosenbaum, who does our foreign relations and who just came back from Greece, actually. He was in Athens on the day of the referendum, so he brought some stories back to tell about what was happening there. How about you, handsome young guy over here?
Don't all get up at the same time.
Oh, well, my name is Patrick Babajani, and I'm working with the ANCA this summer and the Armenian National Committee. And I'm very excited to be here, as I know that we have a lot of good solidarity with the Greek community as well. And we've all been through a lot of stuff at the hands of the Turkey. So, we're here in solidarity. I think we need to work together in order to move forward with these issues.
Well, I think you're right. I have a large Armenian community in my district as well, a new Armenian church, and I was just there. We dedicated a memorial in a park there, and you're right. I always say that our cultures are similar, our history, our food, our music, our church. So you're right. We do have a lot to work together on. So thank you for being here. Anybody else? How about you?
Well, my name is Aslandi Dixon. I actually work for Congresswoman Titus. My family's Greek Cypriot. They were there in the invasion. My mother, my whole family. So I grew up with like a strong Greek Cypriot background, and I visit often.
So you see, you have a voice right in my office. So thank you very much for being here. Call on me anytime.
Thank you, Dina.
Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, what we're going to do right now is we're going to call on the ambassador of Cyprus to the United States, Ambassador George Chakali, someone I've had the pleasure of knowing for many, many years when he was first here in Washington, then went on to serve another very distinguished post in Europe and through the foreign ministry back home. And now he's back here under, again, different circumstances, except for one, his country is still occupied and divided. And he's been doing a tremendous job here, advocating, making policymakers aware of the issues, and advocating to the best of his abilities, and which are many, regarding this issue. And it's been a pleasure to call him my friend and to be working with him as I learn more and more on these issues, because they do change every single day, and you always need to be on top of them. And George is certainly an encyclopedia knowledge on what goes on a day-to-day basis, along with the staff, which many of us here today. So George, it's a pleasure to have you here today. Thank you.
Thank you. Good morning, everyone. Thank you for being here. I just wanted to thank, first of all, Nick, for all the great work you've been doing through AHI. We count on your support. We need it, and it's always been there. Very much appreciated. You're always around, very active. Thank you for that. And also thank you to each and every one of you for being here today, and through you to all the members of Congress that you represent and you work for. We need the support of the Hill in what we're trying to do. It's always been there for us, and we're very appreciative of the support and the active engagement of Congress for our cause. You've heard from everyone so far, the situation in Cyprus has not changed. It's still under occupation, 41 years now. 38% the refugees have still not been able to return to their homes. People are still missing since the tragic events of 74. Properties have been destroyed, churches have been ruined, desecrated. So the effects of the invasion and the continuing occupation are very much still there. We are working to end this finally and to reunify the island and its people. We have a new interlocutor on the Turkish Cypriot side now. And this is the best negotiator that we've been sitting together with in over 40 years. The Turkish Cypriot leader, for the first time, is a person that actually believes in Cyprus. He believes in a common country for the two communities, and he is very much working towards that. There's a very strong personal chemistry with the President of the Republic, and that's why we've been able to advance the negotiations on a number of issues very, very quickly. Since he took over a few months ago. But there are still a lot of thorny issues at hand, all of which do not concern the negotiations between the two sides. They concern directly Ankara as the occupying force. And if Ankara is not directly involved in the negotiations and shows the same goodwill as the two leaders in Cyprus, we won't be able to move on these very difficult issues. You're talking about removal of troops, you're talking about return of property, you're talking about security issues, guarantee issues, colonists. So the issues that are still pending are still very difficult. And these are the issues that we need to get Turkey's continued goodwill and support. So we, on our part, on the island, will continue our work between the two communities as far as we can take it. But beyond that, we need to make sure that Turkey is engaged in the same way as we are, because the decision and the key for the solution ultimately rests with Turkey. We will be needing your support. We know we can count on it. You've been there for us so far. So you'll be hearing from us as things move forward. You've heard the phrase cautiously optimistic. That's where we are at the moment. We've had a lot of support from the US administration in our efforts. We'll need a lot more as things get tougher. But we will persist and we will insist until we unify our country. Thank you for your support, thank you for all you're doing, and we look forward to keeping in touch. Thank you.
We do have another member of Congress who just joined us, and although he's been a newcomer to the scene, David Cicilline, though, has been hitting the ground running since he's been in Congress as an advocate of these issues. And more recently, he's initiated an amendment which was ultimately included in a defense, remind me of the bill again,
Defense Authorization Bill,
that if will hopefully begin the process of having Cyprus's be able to purchase American-made weapons, which right now there is an embargo against Cyprus by the U.S. administration to purchase the weapons, which is just absolutely ridiculous, considering the occupied North has 43,000 military troops and is heavily armed with American-made weapons, which is totally illegal in terms of the transfer of those weapons to the occupied area. But yet we have this archaic legislation that exists in the books. And Congressman Cicilline has made a tremendous first step to remedy that moving forward. He's here with us today, and we welcome him and welcome you to the podium, Congressman.
It's a great pleasure to be here to commemorate this important anniversary. And I'm hoping that the kind of positive signs that we're starting to see, particularly from the Turkish Cypriots, that we're going to, this will be our last celebration of the illegal invasion and occupation of Cyprus by Turkey, and next year we'll be celebrating the unification of Cyprus. But thank you for all of the advocacy that many of you in this room have done. As I mentioned, one of the things when I traveled to Cyprus that I learned was this arms embargo that was in place against an ally who is a very important ally in the region and someone who's been very important in the U.S. efforts to combat terrorism around the world. And it struck me as really peculiar that we would be working so closely with such a trusted ally and yet have an arms embargo in place. And so we began this process to hopefully end that embargo, and I want to acknowledge the work of Senator Menendez on the Senate side who introduced the same amendment in the Senate version. But I think we have reason to be hopeful. I think, as the ambassador said, we have to make sure that Turkey stays in this conversation and recognize that the United States can play a role in helping to encourage the progress of these discussions. And we owe it to the people of Cyprus to make sure we do that. And I promise to do all that I can to make sure the United States plays its role to bring a unified Cyprus. And I want to acknowledge my chief of staff, Pierre Karafotis, who I acknowledge that I had a certain understanding of the issues important to Cyprus, but Peter's leadership of my team here in Washington has made sure that I understand it completely. So, thank you.
And since the Congressman did mention his staff, I was going to wait a little bit later. But I might forget, because it happens to me sometime in my elder years. So let me recognize my staff, which does a tremendous, tremendous work. We are a very small staff, but we do, I think, a lot of things. If you only notice our press releases that come out on a weekly basis. And Yorigia, although she's technically a director of, you know, legislative assistant, she, believe me, has a lot more hats than that. In a small office, we have to wear multiple hats, and she's doing tremendous work. And I want to recognize the work of Yorigia Polizos. We have also a young man, Stephen Kakouris, who's been with us for a year and has been handling, you know, again, multiple hats in the office. But now he's going to be moving on. This will be my last official, in an official capacity, to thank him publicly for his good work over the last year and wish him well as he goes off to the UK and London to pursue his degree, master's degree, and probably make a lot of money. So we wish you well, Stephen. I do want to recognize, actually, it was mentioned here by a number of speakers earlier today that there's a lot of young people in the room, and that is certainly a very good thing, as this issue, some of us are getting up in years, and you know, we need to be able to bring in people through the ranks to understand these issues and to advocate for these issues, because you heard the word cautiously optimism. We've heard that before over the course of the Cyprus issue, and yet here we are 41 years later. We hope this time, really, this thing will get resolved. I believe the will is there on behalf of the leadership, but Turkey still is, unfortunately, the 64,000-pound gorilla in the room that, you know, everybody needs to talk about it and needs to focus on if this thing is going to move forward. And all you need to do is see what Prime Minister Erdogan went to the occupied area to commemorate, well, to, in his case, celebrate the invasion of 1974, and made some very provocative statements. But nonetheless, there seems to be a Turkish leadership that is willing to toe the Cypriot line, but we'll see how much that line will be allowed to be towed without being pulled back from Prime Minister Erdogan in Turkey. But I digressed there a little bit, because what I wanted to say was, and to recognize a couple of individuals who have been important to the overall program of our education of the next generation of Greek Americans. We've had a program where we take students to Greece and Cyprus every year. We just completed our seventh such trip. It's a 17-day immersion trip, which starts off in Washington, continues to Cyprus for 5 days. We go to the occupied area. We go into desecrated churches. We stand on the beaches of Famagusta, while people are swimming on one side in bombed out buildings surrounded by barbed wire fences, and a very ghostly sort of ambiance is right behind. And it's very surreal. And we bring these students in contact with this. And then we go on to Greece, where we do it all over again in a different context regarding what the issues regarding Greece are as they relate to United States relations. And we have a couple of those students who are with us here today. Now, you're here actually as a graduate of this program on the second year, I guess about 5 years ago. And Peter Milios, who was on the program with us last year, is with us. And I haven't seen you since, Peter, so glad to see that you're still doing good things and you're interested in the issue. So thank you for being here. And there she is, Zoe Andrus, who went on the trip this year, and she's studying up in Kenyon College in Ohio. And so I just want to recognize these two students.
Tiffany.
Well, where's Tiffany's outside. The other girl you saw walking in, Tiffany Wells, who goes to school at the University of Alabama and participated in our program last year, and this year she's actually also interning with our office, and she was out in front checking you in when you came in. So I do want to recognize these people because they're a very important part of our program and the continuation of educating the next generation of Greek American and Cypriot American leaders to advocate for these issues. But Ted's a great friend, but he also co-chairs, along with Congressman Bill Arrakis, the Hellenic Israeli caucus, which has been doing a lot of good things on the Hill to promote that relationship, which if you've been following any of the developments, you've known that in the last 3 years, the relation between Greece, Israel, and Cyprus continues to grow, it's strengthened, and it's very important for the projection of U.S. interests in the region, because they are the frontline states in a very dangerous neighborhood. So with that, we do welcome the congressman, and we thank him for being here today. If I can have you come up.
Sure, thanks.
Congratulations. Come spend a lot of money in Florida. We don't have an income tax, so the sales tax is really
important. The Hard Rock Casino takes care of that.
Well, thanks, and thanks for letting me come by. And I'm not the ambassador, but it's nice to be with you. Don't tell him I said so. It's okay. No, it's okay. Don't blame it. It's good to be here today. It's a solemn week. I know there's a briefing and you're going to hear from voices more important than mine, but I just wanted to come to chime in. Monday was the 41st anniversary of Turkey's invasion of Cyprus, and it's obviously an important day for Greek Cypriots, but it's also an important day, I think, for the world. And the attention, any attention that we can bring to commemorate, to note what happened, and to understand the importance of what continues to happen every day in Cyprus and the division of Cyprus because of the occupation, where too many lives have been disrupted, too many families have suffered, and ultimately for those of us who care about human rights, an issue we don't talk enough about here in Washington, frankly, the fundamental rights that have been denied now for too long in Cyprus. So as we mark the invasion and remember the misery that's been imposed on so many, we at the same time, I think, have to try. We always face the future, and we have to try to be hopeful. And as the situation in the Eastern Mediterranean and the wider Middle East continues to be volatile, it's the forcible division of Cyprus that's gone on for too long. And so we have to look at how best to move forward. Since May 15th, the talks have gone on, these UN broker talks. We've been told, and I'd be interested to hear from all of you, that there's been some progress on core issues. That's language that's important to hear. But we still haven't seen results. According to the reports, we're still talking about confidence building measures. Again, I think important. Any bit of optimism, anything that points us in the right direction, is really important. I want to remain cautiously optimistic. I couldn't do this job if I weren't optimistic about the future. I think we all need to approach it that way. But it wasn't even a year ago that the Cypriot government suspended negotiations, rightfully suspended negotiations, because of the Turkish ship that violated the exclusive economic zone, and an action that challenged the trust that had been built in between Turkish and Greek Cypriot leaders. So as we recognize where we are today and where we have to go, it's really small steps toward a comprehensive peace deal that are necessary. And I finish with this. For every day that passes from the invasion, we've got to continue to remember the past. It's vitally important, because without remembering the past, there's no context for what continues to happen today. But also for every day that passes, I think it's really important to look to the future and with hopes for peace, with hopes that we will come together and start marking not just the days since the invasion, but the days since the occupation ended. And I hope that day comes soon, and I appreciate very much the opportunity to enjoy this event. Thank you very much.
Stressed enough, or you may not be aware of, is the fact that human rights was discussed here, and human rights is discussed here on Capitol Hill and in Washington, but it's used as a political punchline rather than policy. And the truth is, though, every time you use the word human rights as it becomes a violation against a person, there's a person behind that violation of human rights, or a family, or suffering. So it should be just used for political punchline, which I've seen all too much used here in the 28 years I've been involved in this issue working on Capitol Hill. Let's call it for what it is, and not call it for political expediency. And I appreciate the fact that the Congressman did bring the issue of human rights and how important that element is. And to that point, even though the whole Cyprus issue is a human rights violation, there's one specific element of it that maybe you haven't picked up on or maybe are not aware of. And that's that there are still 1,619 persons who are still missing from 74, of which four are American citizens. And although they know where a lot of these grave sites are for purposes of being able to excavate and to dig and to find these remains and to bring closure to the families, that you can understand the suffering of these families. And I have visited with the people who do these excavations in Cyprus, and I've been shown bones being laid out on tables and bones, boxes with bones where they're trying to get the DNA and to find who these people are. So this is very important. But yet, they can't excavate in many areas in the occupied area because they are considered to be military zones by an illegal entity called the military occupation of the Republic of Turkey, which is a NATO country occupying a member of the European Union. So think about that. NATO country with a NATO army is occupying in 2015 a member of the European Union. And they will not allow for excavations to take place. And what some in the briefings that I received, not inside literal illegal military installations where there's fences, but in open fields where they just call them military areas. So this is another area I just want to make sure that I highlighted and brought to your attention. And if you're wondering in terms of the perspective, in terms of how many 1,619 are, out of the Vietnam War, there's approximately that same amount, approximately 16-something, that are still missing from the Vietnam War. It took on, was a war that went on for 15, 14 years and was fought with tens of thousands, hundreds of thousands of soldiers. This happened within a couple of weeks period of time in a country that at that time, George, had what, 800,000 total citizens? Staggering in terms of the percentages of a country. So anyway, I did want to highlight that part of it. Let me also recognize somebody who also, unfortunately, will be leaving us at the end of his tenure now, and that's the defense attaché at the Embassy of Greece, Colonel Evangelos Papadopoulos, who's been with us and has never misses an AHI-sponsored event. I certainly appreciate it. You're always making the effort to come with the other attachés, which are with us here tonight, this morning. And you'll be leaving in September, I know. And we wish you all the best in your future endeavors. And the military of Greece does some of the most tremendous work for NATO and for U.S. interest. And for the students who are in this room and who have accompanied me, know when we go, we spend a lot of time visiting military installations and getting defense briefings, because it's a military that in some ways is second to none within the context of the region that it represents. It's one of only four countries in NATO who spends over 2% of the GDP as mandated by NATO, the United Kingdom, the United States, and what is that fourth country your year?
Estonia
spends the other 2%. In Greece, at one time, used to spend 4% of its GDP when times were better. But just a point before we go back onto the Cyprus, because this is all part of the same region, and it's all important. You talk about Greece's economic problems. It has to spend this much money because, unfortunately, it has to chase out its NATO member every single day, which incurs into its territorial integrity, its airspace, and its sea lanes. And we were just briefed there by the defense general staff just a couple of weeks ago when I was there with the students, when I asked the question, what does it cost the Greek state every time they have to send up an F-16 to intercept and chase out a Turkish F-16 on a daily basis? The response was 10,000 euros an hour. That's estimated to be somewhere around a half a billion to maybe even as high as a billion a year when you add in also the fact that they also have to use ships to chase out ships or shadow the ships that come into in Greek sea lanes, sea lanes. When Greece is right now negotiating for its life for money, they have to spend a half a billion to 1 billion, okay, to chase out a NATO ally. And just last week, when the government in Cyprus, in Greece, was having a very difficult vote on this whole process, they escalated on that particular day with 20 types of violations, of which two F-16s were armed, and dogfights took place over the Aegean Sea. I bring this up because necessarily you're not going to be aware of them, but these things happen, and they should not happen. And just like Turkey continues to be, you know, in Cyprus, continues to violate that country and continues to occupy that country, continues to be provocative against Greece, and therefore creates instability for that region, which threatens the instability and the projection of interest of the United States. And that's why I bring it up. So just keep that in mind. And we congratulate you for all the work you've done here representing the Greek Armed Forces in Washington. And I look forward to visiting you at the Pentagon in Athens on my next official visit sometime in the fall. I was wondering if you were gonna show up. I know where your office is, but anyway, ladies and gentlemen, a man who really needs no introduction, certainly. Somebody who's followed in his father's footsteps here and done a tremendous job, and I think he's made his whole family proud. He just as well as his father did over here for 20 years, Gus has followed in those footsteps and continues to make the entire Greek American community proud for all the work that he does here representing U.S. interests as it relates to the southeastern Mediterranean. He wears it on his sleeve too, which I admire him for, and not too many people would do that, but I do appreciate that, and I thank him for it. And he, along with Carol Maloney, is the Republican component and the co-chair of the Hellenic Caucus, which is doing all I can up here and a lot of work to be able to promote these issues, along with his staff, Jeremy, who's there in the back, and thank you for being here, Jeremy. So, Gus, the floor is yours, my friend.
Thank you very much. I appreciate it very much. When you were introducing, when you said a person is leaving us, when you were referring to Evangelos,
yes.
I thought you were talking about me. You must know something I don't know. Because, Nick, I'm not leaving anywhere until, I'm not going anywhere until we resolve our issues with Greece and Cyprus. But Ahi has been around since the invasion, right after the invasion. That was when it was formed, right, Nick? Yeah, by Jean Roussidis and Nick Larigakis. And also Nick worked for the MIAs and the POWs for a few years, and that's very close to my heart. As a matter of fact, we passed a piece of legislation yesterday on the floor of the House, my legislation with regard to our soldiers that have PTS and TBI to make sure that they get the alternative therapies which work, that aren't really offered within the VA now. So we have, I have a veterans meeting right now, it's going on, so I've got to leave in a couple minutes, but I want you to know that again, these issues are very important to us. First of all, our veterans are number one, as far as I'm concerned. It's my top priority in the House of Representatives. But these Greek issues, the issues with regard to Cyprus, these are very close to my heart as well, and they are top priorities of mine, and I say that to the world. You know, I have to work a little harder as a representative. I serve on the Energy and Commerce Committee and the VA Committee, and then I got a waiver for that because the Speaker realizes how important these issues are to me, the VA. But again, you know, we have an obligation and a duty to be great citizens of the United States, but also never forget our people in Ellada and Kipro, okay? And I really appreciate y'all being here because the youth, you're our future. One of these days, we're gonna be too old to serve, right, Nick? So we need people to take over. They have just as much patriotism as we do. I see the ambassador does a wonderful job. So again, there is some optimism, okay, between the leaders, or the President Anastasiadis and the leader on the northern side of Cyprus. But again, we need to keep Turkey out of these negotiations because they're the ones that really throw the monkey wrench into things. So that's so very important that we get the word out. We need to get the word out that Cyprus has been number one. They've done everything the United States has asked them to do. So they're a tremendous ally in a very volatile region. And again, it's up to you to get the word out. We need to be goodwill ambassadors here in the United States. And I push the State Department anytime I can. When I was over there, when Turkey invaded the exclusive economic zone, you know, I wasn't really pleased with the language that the State Department came out with. And I beefed it up a little bit, so it was a good opportunity for me to beef it up on behalf of the United States. We have our former chairwoman of the Foreign Affairs Committee, a number one ally to Cyprus and Greece, and a wonderful friend to me as well, Ileana Ross-Layton. Let's give her a hand, please.
Thank you.
So in any case, our Ellada, we must, again, Greece has been a tremendous ally, getting a lot of bad publicity, but we've overcome anything, haven't we? Over the years, we've overcome everything because we're Hellenes and Americans. So pray for Greece and do everything you can for Greece. I will work with Nick on those issues as well. So thank you very much. God bless you for being here. And again, hopefully next year, we hope and pray that Cyprus will be united. Thank you.
Well, you heard her name mentioned, and she really is a tremendous supporter and advocate on issues in the southeastern Mediterranean. When she was the chair of the House Foreign Affairs Committee, she really led a lot of great efforts, spoke very eloquently, very openly, called for Turkish removal of the troops from Cyprus, which you don't hear that as much from leadership on Capitol Hill, but she did, and she continues to advocate for this because obviously she understands the importance of this in, as it relates to the importance of the United States in the region. So we welcome her today. We thank her for all the support, and it's a real pleasure to have Leanna Rosalind here with us.
Thank you so much. Thank you. It's always a pleasure to be here at any event where my great friend Gus Bilirakis, as I call him, Ray number one, and Liz, Ray number two. That's an inside joke. We'll tell you maybe one day if you're part of our club. But thank you, Gus. I don't mean to have you stick around to have me. They'll have to listen to me. They're the ones that have to listen to me. But it is really a pleasure to come here every year at this wonderful function of the American Hellenic Institute that that Nick puts on, along with so many good friends and the ambassador, etc. And all of us are friends of Greece and Cyprus. And as Gus pointed out, these are difficult times, no doubt. But we've gone through difficult times together, and we will ride through this. And the Hellenic American community is one of the most active, is one of the most effective advocacy groups on the Hill. You know that. You're always engaged promoting the issues that impact the U.S., Greece, Cyprus, always talking about strengthening that alliance and building those bridges. And Nick, I just want to give a special shout out to you as the president of the American Hellenic Institute for always bringing us back here. And I like it that there are young people in the room because we're passing that torch on to you. And I don't know if the food was of the quality of Gus's mom. As you know, when it's when she's the one that's providing the treats, you can count on the best Greek food around. But I get so spoiled by Gus because every time he has an event, we get his leftovers. They're not too many leftovers. They're that good. Everybody eats them before, but he is, Gus is our point man. When it comes to American Hellenic issues, there are people that you turn to say, what is going on? What can we do to help? And Gus is the point man. He's the go-to guy. He represents that community so well, and I feel like it's my community too. And fights for all the issues that that bring us together in Congress. And you know how many good friends and allies you have in our congressional colleagues in a bipartisan manner. And that's a great thing about the American Hellenic Institute is that you've made it a bipartisan organization. And in that, their strength, because we have Gus, but we also have Carolyn Maloney. Carolyn is the other co-chair of the Hellenic Caucus, along with Gus. And she works tirelessly, not only in helping the community, but in putting events, informational events like this one together. But today is a special event. We're here to commemorate the 41st anniversary of the illegal invasion of Cyprus by Turkey. Far too long. 41 years, Cyprus has been divided and illegally occupied by Turkish troops. Hundreds of thousands of Greek Cypriots have been displaced and countless others impacted by Turkey's constant meddling in the internal affairs of Cyprus. The occupation, as you know, has left thousands of Greek Cypriots denied their fundamental right to return to their homes. Freedom of worship, well, you know what has happened, continues to be restricted. Access to religious sites blocked, and we've had ample evidence that we've shown to the international community. It is not he said, he said. No, we have proof that this has been going on. So the time, and speaking of the co-chair, Carolyn Maloney, who will come right after me, but Nick has to give you a good introduction, Carolyn, so you've got to feel the love first. And we all are here to say that the time to end this is now. It is long overdue. 41 years while the world shrugs. I don't want to be back here. As much as I love Nick, as much as I love the American Hellenic Institute, I don't want to come back here. Yet another year to talk about then the 42nd year of the illegal occupation. Enough. The next time that we all come together needs to be in celebration of the end of the occupation and the reunification of Cyprus. We need to redouble our efforts. This has got to be the year to become fully engaged in promoting the reunification of Cyprus, to make sure that this dream that so many have been waiting for 41 years, finally becomes a reality, a dream too long deferred. So let's work together and let's make this happen.
Well, you've heard Cal, as they mentioned here numerous times today. I had the pleasure, and the American Hellenic Institute had the great pleasure, to introduce Carolyn Maloney to these issues when we traveled to Greece and Cyprus a number of years ago. And she was one of the stars of that trip, and she's continuously been advocating for these issues ever since that trip. And we're proud that we were able to make that introduction to you, Carolyn. And I'll never forget, specifically back then, because we went to Greece and visited northern Greece, Macedonia. And of course, at that time is when the issue just started being, you know, in the beginning stages. And she came leaving that trip proclaiming Macedonia in Eliniki and saying it in Greek. And she even had Newt Gingrich saying it at the farewell dinner that we had in Athens the last night. But obviously, Cyprus is, you know, very dear to her, and she's been helping to advocate for this for many, many years. And we thank her so much. And as I said earlier, along with Gus Bilirakis, who basically has succeeded his father as co-chair, Carolyn is the original co-chair, along with Gus's father, of the Hellenic Caucus. And it is really a great pleasure to have with us here today. And we, of course, colloquially know her and lovingly know her as the Bubulina of Capitol Hill. So, Bubulina, welcome.
Thank you so much. And I'm so thrilled to be here with so many great advocates. And I do want to introduce Christina Parisi, who handles Greek American issues and Cypriot American issues for me in the event that I'm on the floor or in a business meeting or something else, so she can answer your questions. And of course, we are absolutely thrilled to have the ambassador here, George Shakali. Thank you for your service and for being here. On that trip, I brought this sign that said, Macedonia is Greek. Now, no one understood what it meant but me at that time, because the great advocate Nick Larigakis had totally schooled me in Rasidis at the time on the whole thing. But by the end of the trip, all of the Republicans, all the Democrats were going and had their own signs. Macedonia is Greek. Macedonia is Greek. And I'll never forget, you make friends on these trips. We had a incident with EMEA where the Turks, with their usual, whatever you want to call it, bravo, I think they just do things to see if somebody's going to stop them or not. They had gone to the island of EMEA and planted their flag, which was an absolute insult to the sovereignty of Greece. And so we had this resolution, and we had this all this work taking place to stop it. And I was working with the Democratic leadership, and I said, you know, by the way, we have Newt Gingrich and we have Jerry Solomon. These were two of the top leaders of the Republican side, and they were like aghast. How did you get them? How did you get them on a Democratic resolution? How did you get them? It was that trip where we were totally schooled on the issues that are important to the sovereignty of Cyprus and the sovereignty of Greece. But today's event is really and truly a sad one, where we honor a dark a day in history, in the history of the world, I'd say, and particularly for Cyprus, the effects of which created an island that is divided to this day. When you think about it, the Great Wall fell down between Germany. The walls have come down in so many places, but still the wall stands in Cyprus. And I refer to July 20th, 1974, when Turkish troops invaded the island and illegally established a territory in the north. segregating Cypriots and creating an instability that has persisted to this day for 41 years. And I'd say 41 years is enough. We have to end this. And Greek Cypriots were forced from their homes, becoming refugees in their own country. And I represent many Greek Cypriots, and they tell me stories of you know, crawling out of Farmagusta on their bellies, running for their lives, and going back to Cyprus and seeing that their churches have been desecrated, that their homes have been destroyed, that their whole way of life was destroyed. The religious and cultural sites were damaged and in many cases destroyed, and their religious freedoms restricted, and their rights and sovereignty disrespected. And it is time for Turkey to withdraw its troops from Cyprus so that the island can move forward as one nation. And there can be no settlement with Turkish troops, 40,000 of them, running around the island. And as all of you know, Turkey continues forcibly to occupy one-third of Cyprus with more than 40,000 troops now. The change in leadership of the Turkish Cypriots, however, this year is reason for to be cautiously hopeful that we will make real progress in reunifying Cyprus. And yet another provocation last fall when Turkish ships entered Cyprus's exclusive economic zone, threatening its sovereignty and interfering with its natural gas exploration activities, which caused President Anastasiades to rightly walk away from the talks, the reunification talks. And I joined with my colleague Gus Blarakis, the co-chair of the Hellenic Caucus, in vigorously calling on the U.S. to actively urge Turkey to remove its ships from Cypriot waters in order to restart the negotiations. And I'm pleased that talks have resumed, and early reports suggest that the discussions are positive and productive. And Cypriots, I would say, have waited too long for peace. Too many years have passed without progress towards reunification. And it's up to Cyprus's friends to make our voices heard toward achieving the ultimate goal of reunification and a prosperous Cyprus, where Greek Cypriots and Turkish Cypriots can live together in peace, security, and stability. Many of my Cypriot residents, I would say, people that I'm privileged to represent, recall with fondness the way the island used to be. It used to be friendly with the Turks. They would go to each other's marriages, they would tend each other's flocks, they were friends. Then this invasion happened, it divided it, and everybody's up in arms. And I will assure you that I will remain committed to supporting this outcome, and the Hellenic Caucus will continue to work to maintain the United States' active engagement in the process. And I want to thank many of you who've become friends, and I thank you for your tireless advocacy for Cyprus and the Hellenic community around the world. I am very proud that one of the successes of the Hellenic Caucus, and we are, I think, the second largest caucus in Congress. I urge all of you when you go home to make sure that the members of your congressional delegation are members of the caucus. That's one way you could help strengthen it. People listen to their constituents, and if you reach out to your representatives and ask them to be parts of this caucus, they will listen to you, and they will join and listen to the issues that are there. But at the time, when Madeleine Albright was Secretary of State, we worked on this project to bring Cyprus into the European Union and into the whole European governance, and we were thinking that that would help build towards reunification, but it hasn't. So let's hope. So I thank you always for the great privilege of being with you. I thank you for your advocacy. I thank you for your friendship. And I thank you for continuing to always keep a very special place in your heart and a special place where a lot of your energy goes into really fighting for Cyprus reunification, getting the 40,000 troops off the island. It's not that easy. I've been successful in a lot of ways, but I haven't gotten the troops off the island. So we need to keep pushing on all of that. But also we need a sharp pencil on the restructuring of the debt for Greece. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much, Carolyn. As you can see, she does take very seriously her position as co-chair of the Hellenic Caucus. Today, obviously, we're commemorating the Cyprus issue, but we cannot forget what's going on in Greece, and she touched upon that very nicely. Carolyn, as you leave the room, one thing you may be aware of, I'm not sure if we've necessarily brought this to your attention of your staff. If we haven't, we will. We wrote a letter to the OPEC president, her name is Littlefield, I believe, Overseas Private Investment Corporation, which is tasked with trying to promote American investment in countries that fall within that criteria. Well, Greece does fall into this criteria, and we would appreciate any help you can to have OPEC look at this a little more seriously, because I'm a little disappointed in that the letter was in on April 30th, and we still have not gotten a response back, even a pro forma response to our letter requesting that OPEC do this and put together a delegation of potential American investors to the country. So anything that, John?
That's a great idea.
And we'll get you a copy of that letter that we sent to OPEC.
Okay, and let's work together to find some investors that will go over there and participate.
I appreciate that. So without further ado, though, a man who really needs no introduction, John Sarbanes, who ever since has come up here and been hitting the ground running. He's very articulate. He understands the complexity of these issues, and he expresses them and advocates them with great veracity. And we thank him very much, and thank you for being here today, John.
Thank you, Nick. So thank you, Nick. Thank A. Shai, Ambassador. It's great to be here with you. I'm thrilled to see all the young people in the room, because you're the ones that are inheriting the legacy that we're talking about today and are going to be part of the advocacy community that ultimately, I believe, is going to result in a reunified Cyprus. As I was driving over here today, somehow I got my head into a positive space thinking about Cyprus. It was a combination of things. One was that we are seeing very, I think, meaningful negotiations and discussions happen. We have in the Turkish Cypriot leader someone who seems genuinely interested in making progress. And of course, President Anastasiades is someone who's brought a real commitment to a solution for many, many years. So perhaps the ingredients are there for us to achieve some meaningful progress with respect to reunifying Cyprus. We still see, as recently as 2 days ago, President Erdogan trying to put a frame on the situation that suggests that, you know, Cyprus and the Turkish Cypriot North is really just kind of a client state of Turkey, and the Turkey calls the shots, and Turkey is the mother, and the Turkish Cypriot community is the child, and so forth. And he's going to continue to put that out there, but as long as the discussions going on between the two leaders of these communities, these two proud communities, is continuing, and there are confidence building measures being put in place, and there's real exploration of that happening right now, there's a reason to be hopeful. But beyond that, what I was thinking was that the ultimate reunification of the island of Cyprus, I think, is in the destiny of that island. I think that it cannot be denied. I don't believe that the reality that Erdogan seems to want to create is sustainable. And I think as long as it may take, we are going to achieve an end where Cyprus is unified once again. Because I think the Turkish Cypriot people and the Greek Cypriot people are determined to see that happen. And they will overcome all obstacles ultimately. Now, the United States has a role to play in encouraging that result, pushing and pressing, and we're all critics here, I think, of many administrations maybe not being as forceful in that regard as we would like to see. I hope that as these current negotiations proceed, there will be critical moments at which the U.S. administration will step in and make sure that any positive movement is carried forward to a good result. But it's going to take organizations like AHI and others who are focused on this and advocates like the young people that we have here today to keep pressing on our own government, our own administration, on our Congress to make sure that this issue stays in front of people in a constructive fashion. So thank you for being here. I'm actually participating in a conference in New York City as we speak. I'm on a Skype call that I've just muted for 15 minutes. I have to get back to that, so I'm gonna close quickly. But I did want to comment on the situation in Greece as well. I see we have Nikki Tsongas, who's going to talk to you in a moment, who's a great ally of our communities here in the Congress, and we work very closely together to make sure we keep these issues in front of our colleagues. We want to see a unified Cyprus inside a unified Europe. And the test that's facing Europe right now is whether sort of its founding principles will be brought to bear at this critical time. It appears that they're ready to invest in a unified Europe, to double down on a unified Europe. The question is whether the sort of formula that they're going to bring to bear is one that's actually going to allow Greece to recover, as Congresswoman Maloney, who's been a real champion as co-chair of the Hellenic Caucus, just described to you. My hope is that because Europe is being as prescriptive as it is right now with respect to what the Greeks should do, that in that way it is taking ownership of the situation in Greece and making it a European project. And that because it is making it a European project, it will then understand, just from a basic economic standpoint, that you can't continue to visit this extreme austerity on the country and expect that project to be successful. So that the discussion about some meaningful debt restructuring and ultimately debt relief will be part of the conversation. You're starting to hear that. I think the United States administration is making the case for that. The IMF has clearly staked out that position in a way that will have leverage over the situation. So hopefully we will see that. But it's also now a challenge for the Greek people, who've had this punishing austerity visited upon them for 5 years and have been the recipients of extreme diplomatic brinksmanship over the last few months. And they're pretty much wrung out by the experience. But I think they have in their character what it takes to ultimately prevail against these very, very difficult odds. But it means that the Greeks and the Greek government are going to have to step up and demonstrate that they can pull together a more functional system, frankly. A system where there's a land registry, where you can go and see who owns what, where there's a civil procedure code, where there's sort of these basic elements of what it means to be part of a unified Europe. So everyone has responsibility going forward, and I'm very hopeful that ultimately Greece will rise from what many view as the ashes of the current situation and rise stronger, rise economically, and I think build up a new and more powerful and more merit-based political infrastructure, which is also very critical. What is the role of the United States in this going forward? Thanks for mentioning the OPIC letter. I think it's important for, as an initial matter, for the administration to pull together a kind of cross-agency or inter-agency technical advisory group that will pull on the expertise that exists within these various U.S. agencies that can then work collaboratively with European counterparts and Greek counterparts to start getting some of this basic infrastructure in place. And I think there will be an opportunity if we can bring that kind of a technical assistance team together to also explore opportunities for investment coming from the Greek American business community and the broader American business community with efforts like the OPIC letter that you described being very much a part of that. So this is a very, very tough time for the people of Greece. It's always a difficult time for the people of Cyprus who have this aspiration to be reunified. But it's also a hopeful time, and I'm committed, Carolyn Maloney, is committed, Nikki Songus is committed, the members of the Hellenic Caucus are committed, along with you, to making sure we do everything we can to achieve a positive result for both Cyprus and for Greece. So thank you for the opportunity, and I'm going to head back and get on my Skype call. Thank you.
To just live the life of a member of Congress. You gotta be able to balance it. Thanks again, John, Carolyn.
Hi, thank you.
As mentioned, with us is another tremendous friend from the great state of Massachusetts, where there is a tremendous amount of Greek Americans in her state, some very well-to-do Greek Americans, professional Greek Americans. Of course, she comes from the education community, and the Cyprus issue becomes one of education, frankly. And she's done a tremendous job in doing that here on Capitol Hill with her members and to supporting this issue and advocating for it. So it is with great pleasure to have Nikki Tsongas here with us today. And Nikki, if I can call you to come up and make some comments, please.
Sure. Thank you.
Thank you. Good morning to everybody. I have to say, first of all, it's always a pleasure to follow John Sarbanes. He's so articulate and so knowledgeable about so many issues, but in particular, really holds dear all the challenges that Cyprus and Greece have had, and I often look to him as a member of the Hellenic Caucus. The second thing I want to say is that as I walked in here, my first impression was, gosh, this is young. And it's great to see so many of you, because one of the things as a member of the Hellenic Caucus I often sort of take passing note of is that many of the members, we are legacy members. I'm a Songus. John is a Sarbanes, Gus is a Bilirakis. These are all families that have, we've had predecessor members here. My husband was here, John's father was here, Gus's father was here. So my point is that by seeing you all here, you're demonstrating an interest in the political life of this country. Perhaps it's the future of Cyprus or of Greece that brings you here. But I would want to encourage you to think more broadly about getting engaged, because we need new members coming from the Greek American community who bring the passion and the interest in some of these issues that are naturally part of who you are. And in the course of it, you will also then be an advocate for all the other things that you happen to care about. But your presence here today tells me you understand what's possible here. The other thing is sometimes you also have to understand as a member what's not immediately possible here. So I remember as a newly elected member of Congress from California saying to me, one of the things she had to get used to was how long it takes to get something done. But on the issue of Cyprus, it's obviously taking us altogether too long. I remember when my husband was a presidential candidate in 1992, as he was part of a rally in New York City in opposition to the partition of Cyprus and calling upon the two sides to come together and bring the country back together. So that's 23 years ago, and we're here today to commemorate the 41st anniversary of the division, the occupation of Cyprus and the division of that country. So 41 years is altogether too long, and I remain hopeful, and to hear Congressman Sarbanes comment again on the hopes that he has that we're in a new and different place, we have to all hope. Make sure that that is the case, and the Hellenic Caucus certainly does work hard to maintain this issue in the forefront, because it is so easy, given all the other things that are on our plate, for this to become sort of sidelined. And it takes all of you coming, as many others do over the course of a given congressional year, legislative year, to bring that issue to us. So we're here to be helpful. Again, I commend all of you for being here. We're all watching so closely, as Congressman Sarbanes commented, on what's happening in Greece, and I think both understanding the need to find a way forward that acknowledges the pain that has been inflicted on the people of Greece, but also the obligations that the people that have to be absorbed in finding a way forward. It's got to be a balanced approach that does not exact too much future harm, but also holds the country to some much needed reforms. A great challenge, but one that we're all very much focused on. So I thank you all for being here. It's a busy day. Technology allows us to be in many places at once. I don't know if that's a good thing or bad, but it's great to have you all physically present here, and our office is always open to hearing from you and wanting to be part of the solution. So thank you all.
Thank you very much, and you appreciate it. The Congressional Delegation of California has always been in the lead on supporting these issues for many years. No one more so than Congressman Brad Sherman, who for many years we've had the opportunity to work together with his staff and him, and him being in the lead on so many of the advocacy regarding these issues, and we can't thank him enough. And as he likes to say, and I'll say for him today, he likes to come from one of the best named cities in the country, Sherman Oaks, California, Congressman Brad Sherman.
Hello, indeed, I am Brad Sherman from California's best named city, Sherman Oaks. With me is my foreign policy advisor, Arlette Abrahamian. Ms. Abrahamian is known for her skepticism of the Turkish government. Everything's been said. I may be just about your last speaker. So just boil together everything else everyone else has said and give me credit for it. I'll incorporate it by reference. This is a tough economic time for Greece, but that does not mean that it's a time to ignore the actions of Turkey, not only in Cyprus, but also with the churches, church property, and ecumenical patriarchate of the Orthodox Church. And it is, and when we focus on economic matters, it is obviously in the world's interest that the natural gas and petroleum available in Cypriot waters be exploited. And there is nothing that Turkey has done, well, there's a few things they've done almost as outrageous, but to interfere with that effort. In doing so, they declare that they control the waters off of southern Cyprus, while at the same time occupying northern Cyprus. I have yet to have them even articulate what their position is, except to say that they have a navy and they want to use it for mischief, as they have for over 41 years. On that point, one of my first, I've been on the Foreign Affairs Committee for 19 years, one of the first things we considered 19 years ago was whether to transfer frigates to the Turkish Navy. I'm aware of the Turkish Navy's efforts 41 years ago. I am not a fan of their work. But it was being pushed on us, saying, well, Turkey has in a dangerous neighborhood. They border Iran. They border Iraq. And I raised the question, in their efforts vis-a-vis Iran, and that was Saddam Hussein's Iraq, where would they deploy the frigates? The last time an ocean-going vessel was seen in eastern Anatolia, its captain was named Noah. So I will look forward to getting your input as to how we can be effective at this difficult time, and how we can be effective with a particularly difficult government in Ankara. And I want to thank you for the input you've given me over the years that has guided my efforts. Speaking of guides for all of us, we have the ranking member of the Foreign Affairs Committee, back and strong. And his name, of course, is Elliot Engel, but I'll let you introduce him.
Thank you. Thank
you. Well, as mentioned, and we are coming up on the 11 o'clock hour, but last but not least, certainly somebody who has fought on this hill for many, many years and advocated for these issues. We can't thank him enough for all the work that he's done, the yeoman's work he's done over the years regarding these very important issues. And it really is a pleasure to have him here with us today. As mentioned, the ranking member of the House Foreign Affairs Committee, Elliot Engel, from New York, the Empire State. We welcome you here, Mr. Engel, and we welcome you to come to the microphone to say a few words.
Good morning, everyone. Or is it already afternoon? I'm going to be very brief because many of you have been here for a long time, and I'm sure you've heard the same thing over and over again. I agree with everything that everybody has said here. This is my 27th year in Congress, and 41 since the invasion. So since the very first time I stepped foot in the Congress as a member and joined the Foreign Affairs Committee, I've been speaking out against the Turkish invasion of Cyprus, and occupation, the illegal occupation of Cyprus. And the very first piece of substantive legislation that I passed way back within the late 1980s or early 1990s involved the missing in Cyprus, American citizens missing in Cyprus. And that was my first piece of substantial legislation. And here we are all these years later, and it seems like not much has changed. So rather than repeat everything, let me just say this. The invasion the Turkish invasion of Cyprus happened with U.S. complicity. We don't like to say that, we don't like to mention it, we don't like to talk about it. But the fact of the matter is the United States knew this was happening, didn't do anything to stop it, and almost seemed to acquiesce to it. Turkey has a terrible record, not only with regard to Cyprus, but with regard to many other things in the Middle Eastern region. And I think as a NATO ally, or a supposed NATO ally, Turkey needs to be called to the carpet for its actions and for what it has done. It is very important that the United States stand with Cyprus. An undivided Cyprus needs to happen. This division, I remember years ago, we're going to Nicosia and looking at the difference between the Turkish side and the Greek side. One side, in those days, the Turkish side was all barricaded, and the Greek side was free for people to move about freely. So I think the United States needs to exert some leadership here. We need to make sure that this illegal occupation, which divides an island, which divides a country, is ended. The good thing, of course, is that no country has recognized the northern part of Cyprus, only Turkey, and Turkey couldn't get anybody else to recognize it. But Turkey's got no right to lecture other countries or to tell other countries what to do when you look at its record in Cyprus. And it isn't only Cyprus. We see Turkey's record now with Syria. We see Turkey playing footsie with terrorist groups as a NATO ally. We see Turkey doing all these things, and they need to really be called on the carpet for it. So I just want to tell you that this will always be a priority issue for me until the last illegal Turkish soldier leaves Cyprus. We need to leave Cyprus to the Cypriots. We need to make sure that the problem is not imposed on Cyprus, but that the people of Cyprus alone decide. And the United States, as the leader of the free world, has a very, very important role to play one right now. So it needs to back off. Again, it's going to take U.S. leadership, but be assured that those of us in Congress, Mr. Sherman, myself, and other leaders of the Foreign Affairs Committee, we will always be there for Cyprus and always be there for Greece, and we'll make sure that it becomes and continues to be a bipartisan issue, that it's not an issue of one party, it's an issue of simple justice, peace and justice. So the occupation needs to end, and the sooner the better. Thanks for listening.
I think he said quite a bit, and believe me, no one else said it quite like you today, so I want to thank you very much for that very eloquent and sweeping presentation that you made regarding the Cyprus issue. We're gonna end it here, but let me provide just some closing thoughts, if I may. 41 years ago, the American Hellenic Institute started because of the Cyprus invasion, and we're committed to continue to be there until this issue is finally resolved. Resolved where Cyprus is whole, free, and at peace. In 74, one of the biggest victories that our Greek American community has had was being able to work together and to place an embargo against a country of NATO called Turkey. This was not a very easy thing to do in those days when there was major opposition to such an endeavor. But we did it because the U.S. law was violated. The Foreign Assistance Act was violated when American weapons were used in the illegal invasion of Cyprus. So we were able to use the U.S. law to be able to push our agenda forward. It's that message that we continue to bring today. U.S. law is still being violated every single day on Cyprus by that 43,000 troops there and with the American-made weapons there. Speak nothing of the U.N. Charter, the NATO Charter, and customary international law and the rule of law. So therefore, we need to be vigilant to continue to push in that direction. But that means, as the ranking member just mentioned, there's a responsibility here on behalf of the government at any time in the United States. And that's where we become effective the most, to be able to point out the double standards that sometimes exist as it relates to how our governments over the years have dealt with these issues. Let me just bring up one small example. About four months ago, Assistant Secretary of State Victoria Nuland, before the House Foreign Affairs Committee, in reference to Ukraine and the invasion there by Russia, she spoke of that action in these terms, in terms of an illegal invasion. She also referred to it as that we cannot have larger countries bully small countries. And she also said, we've been working in the United States for the last 40 years to promote a Europe that's whole, free, and at peace. I've yet to hear those words, though, regarding Cyprus. And I've never heard from anyone in the State Department say those words in the 28 years that I've been involved in this issue. And unfortunately, to the contrary, when we do engage policymakers at the White House and in the State Department predominantly, they never want to openly criticize Turkey because they feel that's not the proper way to do it. Well, I totally disagree. And we need to be able to say it publicly, because if we don't say it publicly, it's not going to work. And as much as there's goodwill right now in Cyprus, and we're all cautiously optimistic, unless the United States put its weight behind the negotiations in the way of keeping Turkey in check, this, unfortunately, I think is going to come down that same path again that we've all been disappointed for 41 years. And that's just reality. And we need to be able to understand that. Because I don't know how much Mr. Erdogan is going to allow Mr. Akinci, okay, that rope I talked about earlier. I'm hoping that he will. But he only will if he understands there's going to be consequences from the United States and the rest of the international community. So that is the message that ultimately will bring the final solution to Cyprus, so that country can be whole, free, and at peace in a just and viable solution. And we long for that day so we can come up here and not have any more of these ridiculous commemoration anniversaries, but have a celebratory anniversary. Regarding Greece, as it's been mentioned, and we were just there recently, it is really despicable what has happened there without going into all the details. I think if you read newspaper articles on a daily basis, you can create your own opinion. But it's a fact that the problem is there today. I do say this, though. I am optimistic regarding Greece, only for one reason. It's been there for 3,000 years. It's gone through tremendous upheaval and turmoil within its 3,000 years history. From invasions, from multiple times, occupations, military juntas, civil wars, so forth, so on, and so on. And it still has endured, and its people have endured. So again, as people have heard me say before, I just can't believe the present-day Hellene will allow an economic crisis bring down the glorious history of what's called Greece. Because, as I also like to say, failure isn't an option. And that's why Greece will continue to endure. And Greece is open for business. There's no padlock on the door. As I will go there next week and I will spend my 1 month vacation there helping the Greek economy as best as I can personally, and I encourage those who can to do the same. It's not to say, though, that mistakes haven't been made, and unfortunate ones at that. But from where we stand, and in the United States and the American Hellenic Institute, we always look at what can we do. And you heard me speak earlier regarding the OPIC letter. This is an agency, okay, that the President of the United States appoints its president. That's President Obama, who's been in the forefront in helping Greece in regard to the recent negotiations by making the phone calls and other behind the scene pressure that's been implied by the White House against European leaders to put together where we are today. Its mandate of this organization is to help American investment in countries where American investment is needed. There are other agencies in the context of the United States government, okay, that Greece can look to engage them to be able to help in its economic recovery. Not for the immediate future, but its long-term future, because ultimately that's where it needs to go. You just can't have a band-aid solution. You need to have a long-term solution. And even the Bible gives us a very nice illustration to that. If you give a man a fish, you feed him for the day, you teach him how to fish, you feed him for a lifetime. And that's what Greece needs. But that means, of course, Greece has to do its part as well. And right now, there's no good climate for investment in Greece. Although there might be some, and I think there will be, that will look at this as a potential advantage of a situation to go and invest in Greece, because ultimately you also want to invest when prices are down. But other things have to be equal too, without getting into the details. But Greece does face a challenge, and we at the Institute will do what we can to continue to promote and raise the level of awareness and whatever we can to try to make it easier for them as well, in terms of some of the things I just mentioned to you within the context of the U.S. perspective. So it's with that I will leave you. I thank you once again for coming out here today and to commemorate this unfortunate continuing anniversary. And we hope next year, if we do have to be here, it'll be in the celebratory way and not in the commemorative way. So thank you once again. Enjoy the rest of the summer. And George, I think you're leaving today. Wish you good luck, good trip. And give my best to the folks in Cyprus. Take care. Thank you.